Welcome, everybody. I would like to introduce Mr. Holger Eisenberg. He is a member of the Mars Society NorCal chapter, and he will be speaking with us today on aerial morphology by plasma processors. Mr. Eisenberg, please go ahead.
Yeah, hello, I welcome every listener here from wherever you are joining on Earth or wherever else. And today I'd like to raise the question, if the surface of planet Mars was shaped, formed by processes related to plasma. That's a question which has been discussed already since 70 years by various individuals and researched. And in recent years, more information about actual practical experiments has been made public, and some of those I will show today here. And all those experiments have not done by me, by other individuals. I'm just combining them, presenting them here to give a summary of the topic. The candle flame you are seeing here provided light in the dark for centuries. And in a demon-haunted world, it can help as protection. But what not many know, it actually produces a plasma inside the flame by separating the electrons from the hot gas molecules and thereby ionizing the gas, and an ionized gas is a plasma. The strength of the plasma is defined by electron density, and here with a candle flame, the electron density is quite low, but with higher temperature, like in this cutting torch you see on the lower right, with temperature going up to 3000 Kelvin, more ionization is happening, and that already gives or associates the name plasma torch to this tool. So at higher temperatures, more energy is introduced and creating a more dense plasma. In other applications in today's world, plasma is used. Simple use case is a standard fluorescent light. Or here, what is visible on top and upper right, some more advanced plasma light systems, which are now used in parallel to LED, where the plasma and originally the gas is enclosed in a quartz bulb without any electrodes introduced into them. And the energy is added to the gas and thereby exciting it to a plasma by microwaves, or on the upper right, by an electromagnetic oscillating field, and thereby introducing energy into the gas, producing plasma, and the plasma is producing the light. And the difference between those two lights here I'm showing, on the left, it is creating a hot plasma, that means high temperature can be sensed in the bulb, up to 3000 Kelvin, and on the upper right, almost the lamp is almost running at room temperature, and that is because energy is focused in the electrons of the plasma, which can be measured, but it cannot be felt when touching it, so it feels like room temperature. The same is valid for the plasma globe you are seeing on the lower right, which is also using a cold plasma, and this plasma globe shows one interesting, and here for this presentation, important characteristic of plasma, that it conducts electricity with a high enough electron density. It is even conducting electricity better than the metal copper. And you see the electric currents running in the plasma globe as streamers from the center electrode to the outside glass where it is touched, and the touch creates different capacity and is preferred by the electric current to reach it in those locations. In our solar system, we also have it completely filled with plasma. Here you can see the inner planets up to even Jupiter on the lower right. And this object which you're seeing here, this spiral sheet-like object, is an electric current flowing in this surface into the sun. the current has been estimated to be 3 gigaamperes by simulations. And it is, the sheet is flowing between the northern and southern magnetic field of the sun, which is rotating about once per month. So the whole spiral structure is rotating about every 27 days. It was predicted in the 1950s by Eugene Parker, and later, about 2 decades later, actually discovered and measured that it is existing. So we see we have a medium to transfer energy in the solar system, and energy is actually transferred in the form of electric energy. One aspect of planetary surfaces, which is mostly characterizing them, are craters. And here we see one of those specimens on one planetary surface. It was discovered in Scotland on a beach after an electric thunderstorm. It is only about 1 meter diameter, and it looks like one of those typical craters we know from surfaces like Mars or the Moon or other planets outside of Earth with less processes ongoing in the atmosphere. And this crater was created by an overflowing storm drain. So not by electricity, but by energy stored in water outflowing there. But it's interesting that this different type of energy is producing the same type of crater we know from the standard crater on photos from solar system objects. Here's some other craters also looking like craters on Mars or Moon, a bit more bowl-shaped with a diameter of 50 to 400 meter. And these are located in the desert of Nevada. Here's the largest one. And those have been created in the 1960s by underground nuclear explosions, intentionally to check if those explosions can be used for large earth movements, earthworks. And the result is interesting. Again, they look like those typical impact craters known from the surface of Mars or the Moon. And the energy is here coming from underground, also kinetic energy, provided by the nuclear underground explosion. Here are some other craters. On the top left, also an impact crater created by an object hitting the ground, but it is only a few millimeter across, created in the lab. And on the upper right, a crater looking really similar, but that one was created by an electric discharge through plasma above the surface into the substrate in the lab. And again, the same result, different energy sources. And here on the upper right, we have actually plasma conducting electric energy producing the crater. Another experiment in the lab on the upper left in a reduced pressure environment, where we actually can see the glowing plasma as column reaching from the top electrode, which is not visible, to the surface substrate, which is sand here, and creating a crater, a bowl-shaped crater, within a few seconds to maybe a minute. That means it is a fast process, but it is not an instantaneous process like an impacting object would create it within a few nanoseconds, milliseconds. But the result looks like a bowl-shaped impact crater created by electric energy through plasma. On the bottom and right, different types of electrically through plasma created craters on other substrates, I guess metal on the right, on the bottom left, some soil-like material, also only a few millimeter to a centimeter in diameter. Some are even side effects of modern metal tool systems like electric discharge machining, those cratering effects are unwanted effects of the vibration process, but they are actually happening, and the result is just a different scale, but looks like surface craters on planetary objects. Another example here of electrically created craters in the lab, here on compressed metal oxide powder on the bottom and on the right. Metal oxide is one of the large components of normal soil on planetary surfaces. The result shape also looks like planetary craters. On the upper left, the substrate was salt, with different shape. All are created by electric current through plasma. Here, the surface of Mars in a region about 300 kilometers across. And we see normal craters. And I marked smaller craters on the rim of those primary larger craters. And you can see in this small region, those secondary craters precisely located on the crater rim. Precisely means the center of the smaller secondary crater is precisely located on the rim of the larger crater. And it is difficult to explain that as a result of random processes like a breakup of an impacting object before hitting the ground, that would not have a high probability to always or often create this precisely located secondary crater on a rim. But in a lab, this effect can be easily reproduced. Here an example where a bowl-shaped crater is first created on the upper left middle picture. By an electric discharge, you see the plasma glowing again. Within a few seconds, the wet clay material is excavated into a flat bowl. And after a few more seconds, when the bowl is getting deeper, the distance between electrode and the bottom of the crater is increasing. The arc suddenly moves to the rim, maybe because the distance is no closer between electrode and the rim than to the bottom, or the conductivity of this material on the rim is better. And it locks in there and creates a secondary crater, precisely located on the edge of the rim. And that can be easily reproduced multiple times, and you won't get secondary craters, or only with low probability you will get secondary craters outside of this location. Another famous surface feature on Mars are those mesas, flat top mountains. Here, location about 300 to 500 kilometers across. A similar one where you see those flat top mountains and rills or relatively flat valleys in between. And this same structure can also be created in a lab by placing an electrode on top of compressed here clay and carbon powder, and the other electrode is the ground below the table here as a metal plate. And when introducing here an AC current of 10 kilovolts through the material, the sides of the originally completely flat surface is broken away and creating a kind of mesa with sharp edges and apparently erosion features like we know from deserts on Earth and also on other planets. And you see the material is moved away as dust clouds here, seeing on the right. Maybe a combination of plasma-induced effects with electrostatic effects, but the result is a mesa like we have seen on Mars. And if you don't like those sharp surface edges, you can also create more round shapes with DC current here in the lab with this material here. Sand was used, also 10 kilovolts, in a similar process, and it also creates those flat valleys between the originally flat surface. The smaller surface features on Mars are the famous hematite spherules, also known as blueberries. They have been found in 2004 by the Opportunity rover. and are distributed in large areas there on the surface in a single layer. That means they are not heaping on top of each other, a single layer. And their size is has been measured to be up to an upper limit of 6 millimeter only. Similar spherules are known on Earth as Mochi marbles in the desert of Utah, where they are about 5 times the size, but similar objects are also visible there, also in similar locations on top of those sedimentary like stones. And these small spherules can also be created in a lab. Here, an example running electric current through clay. And within a few seconds, those small spheres are created on the top of the clay. Originally, it was a completely flat surface. And somehow the material inside the clay, maybe some metal oxides, are converted into liquid metal and moving to the surface and forming this small spheroid there within a few seconds. Then back to larger features, famous fractal dendritic-like structures on Mars. The image is crossing about 200 to 300 kilometers here again. You see very sharp edges, vertices, not round curves, on, at least on the lower left image. Here, the same area again, under a nighttime infrared image to increase the contrast. Note the really sharp corners there. The valleys are following. And the tree-like structures in the end following into small twigs. Here, similar dendritic structures, also several hundred kilometers across. Again, similar also on Mars. And they can be created in a lab again in a smaller scale by applying high voltage through here wet wood material. And within a few seconds, you get this nice tree structure, which is actually used by many woodworkers now as ornaments on tables, for example, where you also see the glowing plasma here conducting the current with a heated wood, producing the same structure here also in wood. And on the lower left, other material, unintentionally an electric discharge in a device here on polycarbonate, also creating this tree-like dendritic structures. They are called Lichtenberg figures because Mr. Lichtenberg discovered them in the 18th century on doing electrostatic effects on dust. Now to the largest structure on Mars, 2,700 kilometer long Valles Marineris. We see it here. It's mysterious. First, it looks like a normal valley, maybe, but you know that. At least the lower right part is a straight line in the main trench. Then the main trench is following a slight curve to the left. And next to it, you see parallel lines in many locations following the main trench, which is a bit mysterious how to explain that if some kinetic energy has formed this trench. But and in some locations, you are missing conditions for potential sediment outflow, like in the upper locations. It looks like there is some outflow potential, but it is here blocked by a natural dam. So this deeper basin, this depression here, cannot outflow to this flat valley here because it is deeper and blocked here. So note the straight line here, the curve is interesting, the parallel lines. And I remembered that I've seen this curved and straight line combination, which is not an effect of the map prediction here, even with this being a flat map. And the same shape can be seen as ground track of satellites in a slow orbit here, really at an orbit of 10 to 15 hours per period at their revolution. And that creates a ground track. So it means ground track if you connect the center of Earth to the satellite. And this connection line then follows this shape on the surface. You have to remember that Earth is rotating here, and the combination of the rotation of Earth with different surface velocity, which is largest on the equator and slowest on the pole, creates in combination with the constant speed of the satellite this S-shaped pattern. A detail is that the curve, it is always curving to the equators, towards the equator here. And it is not this sine pattern we know from other low Earth orbit satellites, because this sine pattern is effect of the map projection. If you take a look at the globe, there are almost straight lines following the great circles. You get the same pattern also for non-orbiting satellites here. Just an example that is not related to my theory here or to Mars at all. It just showed to show a ground track of an object in solar orbit. Here the BP Colombo mission to the on the way to Mercury, which is following a flyby maneuver along Earth to speed up. And here you see that the curve is pointing away from the equator, here to the left. And but again, you see, you get the same surface, S-shaped surface track, which looks like the larger scale shape of Valles Marineris. So there is, if you could consider that the energy which was producing Valles Marineris was coming from an object in orbit or in solar orbit, the connection line between this object, this energy source, and the center of mass would follow a track on the ground which would mirror the large scale shape of Valles Marineris. And on Earth, there's a similar feature, 20 kilometer long only, so a smaller scale and not curved, but we also see parallel lines here. And this is actually a ridge, so an elevated feature here. It might be an optical illusion, but these straight lines are an elevated feature, a mountain ridge located in the northeast Sahara in Libya. And a larger context look here, here it is located, shows that it is completely out of context. You don't see any other similar lines in the large area around, so several hundred kilometers. It doesn't fit into the location there. It might be an opportunity to find out how this was created, if it's easier to reach in the Libyan desert or investigating on Mars. It's an interesting question. Again, we hear similar features on a much different scale, only 1 millimeter long. And I remember those when I took images from a scanning electron microscope of granite. To make that possible, to take a photo of granite with an SEM, you need to plasma sputter it with a conductive material. Here, carbon dust was used, and apparently we made an error or fault that it wasn't completely sputtered, and this error then caused this interesting parallel lines patterns to appear, which are really resembling this one here.
5 minute warning.
It's interesting, though. It's a completely different scale, but similar shapes, and it is created by electric discharge through plasma. So that's all for today I have. Thank you for attending and listening, and I'm open for questions now. And here in the presentation, I list famous pioneers of who have researched this aspect of plasma effects in space. Interesting YouTube channels you can join to see the actual experiments. And here's a complete list of image credits for each slide if you want to see details there. I'm open for questions now, then please ask them.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Eisenberg. Hold on just a moment. I'm sorry, this is Carrie. Carol will read them from the chat box just so that we don't have a bunch of people speaking over each other. So give Carol just one moment and she'll start reading the questions to Holger. Thank you. Okay.
Okay, so your first question is, where is your lab situated?
All those experiments I showed are not done by me. They are done by various individuals. And you can see who had done it by the image credits I show on each slide and in the end list there. So I'm not doing those experiments myself. Only those SEM images I did once. It was at the university in Germany, but it was not related to this research. It was a different project.
Okay, and the second one is, to what scale can these setups for making craters and other formations be built?
Yeah, the interesting aspect of electricity and plasma is that it scales infinitely, almost as you could see in the slide I showed, the Parker spiral in the solar system. That's even the largest object structure in the solar system. The current is not that high if you compare it with the large scale of the sun. The density is only a few milliamperes per square kilometers. So in a lab, those experiments have only been done to a few, maybe 3 centimeters in diameter.
All right. When you observe these plasma craters in the laboratory, can you find any crystal as when lighting hits a sand surface?
Yeah. I didn't have done those experiments myself, and I guess they found different modifications of the original material because the plasma electricity induced high energy effects into those, and the material was most likely then reshaped and modified chemically also.
Do lab experiments with different compounds produce reproducible patterns?
Yeah, like I showed, one was, for example, the compressed metal oxide, which looked a bit different than those in salt or on sand. But if you stay on the same material, you get the same shape repeatedly.
What pattern do the fractal formations follow? Is it determined by the path of least resistance through the material or something else?
I guess the main channel you saw, for example, in this woodworking image is directed by the best conductivity, and then the separate, the branching features, their characteristic is that they are branching away. They're always branching. Why? I don't know. That would be a better question to those individuals who did research. And there was even one paper I pointed out in the presentation in 2011 that was, it's a link to one of the metal oxide dust photos.
Are you speaking again during this conference?
No, currently, I'm positively not. I worked together with the presentation with Bill Gardinia, who is presenting it on Saturday, but I'm not doing other presentations here this conference. In previous conferences, I published about digital image processing, especially color calibration of Mars surface images. You find on YouTube if you search for Mars Society. You can find about those topics. So any further questions? I guess we have been through the list here.
Does anyone else have any further questions?
I see one question about Valles Marineris or G0 crater.
But I'm not sure what the question was. Oh,
the G0 crater is a circular crater feature, and Valles Marineris is this straight line with a slight curve and those parallel lines, so it is not looking like a crater. I guess it was once considered to land a rover inside Valles Marineris, but the risk is higher to crash there in this smaller locations. That was most likely the reasons not to land there now, but maybe later.
And do you think plasmas can be used to create useful structures?
That's an interesting question. also how to utilize these observed forces. That's an interesting question. Currently it is used for cutting, light, also cleaning in medicine, not yet for building, but it might be used to use it as energy sources in general for electricity.
Are the effects created mostly by electrons or also by ions?
Yeah, there I don't know that much in those details. I know about electricity a bit, but not so much about the details of plasma. That would be also better to direct it to someone else.
Any more questions? Thank you, Mr. Eisenberg, so much. We greatly appreciate you giving your time to us today. It's been a very interesting speech, and we hope to hear from you again soon. Thank you all for joining us. Please continue watching the other conferences that are available tonight and this weekend. Everyone have a great day, and we'll see you soon.
Thank you.